I'm fascinated with how the brain learns. So how do we learn? What happens in our brains when we learn a new fact or we acquire a new skill? And that really frames the research that I do, the research that my lab works on, and really the direction that we're going. So, oops, I got a little excited. This is my brain. And what I'm showing you here is, Cheryl was kind enough to explain the axons of neurons in the brain. So we have these brain cells called neurons, these long connections that go from place to place in the brain, up and down in our spinal cords. And what I'm showing you here is a diffusion weighted image of my own brain that's showing you all the connections that my brain is making in different directions. So the color coding here is quite lovely, but it also is telling us whether those connections are running side to side, front to back, and up to down, up and down. And this is one of the methods that we can use to try to understand how the brain changes as we learn. So how do we learn? So what are you all doing this morning in your brains as you sit here with us in CVH? So learning happens by the brain changing really globally in three different ways. And they're important ways, and they're ways that we can actually map in the human brain using new technologies. So the first way that your brain changes, and the fastest way that it can change, is by changing chemical concentrations. So neurotransmitters can be increased or decreased. And that actually supports your short-term memory. So as we remember something in a very short time scale, we rapidly change the accumulation of these neurotransmitters. And we can actually map these in the human brain using something called magnetic resonance spectroscopy. So we can look at how this is changing in relatively short time scales for human mapping, and understand that this is very important for our short-term memory accumulation. So the second way that your brain changes is by changing its structure. So we can elaborate these connections. And this also is an important map for us to understand how the brain is damaged after something like a stroke or a brain injury. And then the last way that your brain can change is to change the way it's functioning. So different brain areas can be on at different times in response to different stimuli. And then together, all of these things are happening. And that's how you learn. That's how you change. And I would argue to you the most exciting thing that we've learned in neuroscience in the last 20, 25 years, since I've been lucky enough to be in the field, is that these processes are happening all the time, constantly throughout life. So they happen when we're born, and they actually, and luckily for me, continue, and they will continue until the day that I die. My brain will be changing. But the important part about that is your brain can change for the better, so you could spend a day learning about it in the Center for Brain Health, but it also can change for the worse. So you are less active, you're less engaged, or you have some type of neurodegeneration or damage. Your brain changes the other way. So it's this amazing potential to actually harness brain change and to think about, well, what things could I do to change my brain to make it more healthy, to make it more robust and more resilient against disease and damage? And that's really where we come in to the next part of what I'm very, very interested in my lab. So I studied learning. I'm fascinated with learning. Just been amazing to be a neuroscientist in this time where we've discovered that the brain is neuroplastic. And to put some context on that, as John mentioned, I started my career actually as a basketball coach. I'm tall, and it was really my only skill after I played basketball in college. I had a degree in English literature. I was going to be an English professor. And I was lucky or unlucky enough to destroy one of my knees. So I got to do a lot of physical therapy. And I thought, oh, that seems good. It seems like someone might pay me to do that. I could still kind of be a jock and work out a lot. So I became a physical therapist, and I realized that orthopedic physical therapy, it's like the icing on the cake. But neurology, neuroscience, and neurorehabilitation, that's actually the cake. You're taking someone with a massive disability, you're trying to return them to their daily life. That's probably a lot more important than helping someone run just a little bit faster. I don't know. That was my take on it. So I became a neurophysical therapist, and I worked with stroke. And after about 2 years of treating stroke patients, I realized this terrible thing, and that's what I really couldn't help them as much as I wanted to, or as much as they needed me to. And it was because I didn't understand how this magnificent thing worked. Like, what is happening up there? And just about the time I had my midlife crisis quite early, mid-20s. It's good, because now I'm free from it now going forward. But about that time, these first reports started coming out of the brain can change. Now, when I got my master's in physical therapy, we were taught that the brain never changed after really adolescence. It's pretty static. And in fact, you would lose neurons. You basically just lost neurons your whole life. And it was kind of this terrible downward spiral. And it turned out it's not true at all. It's not true in the least. And our brain is constantly changing. And kind of this realization, I needed to know more about the brain in combination with, oh my gosh, it's changing. And what could we do to help it change? Led me back and led me into neuroscience. And it's really been the best series of unplanned events of my life and has led me here today. So the problem that then we take and we think about brain change in the context of is stroke. And this is the major problem that we study in my lab. So stroke is typically a disruption of blood flow in the brain. And most common it occurs when you have a clot that breaks loose from some vessel in your body. We accumulate plaques on the insides of our blood vessels throughout our life. And we can make this better or worse by doing things like diet and exercise and high blood pressure, the things we all know we need to take care of. When one of those clots breaks loose, if it becomes lodged in a vessel that's small in the brain, it will impede blood flow. And then our neurons will rapidly die as blood flow is lost. And in fact, when you have a stroke, we often say that time is brain. And we say this because you lose about 1.9 million brain cells, million neurons a minute as a stroke occurs. And so that is why it's such a major medical emergency. Many of us often wait a long time before we actually seek medical care. Women are much worse about this than men, by the way. And so we wind up with much more significant disability. So this is what a stroke actually looks like. Now, thankfully, this isn't my brain. This is the brain of one of the individuals we've studied in my lab. What I'm showing you here is a little different than what I showed you before. This is an anatomic brain image from MRI taken here at UBC. And we're looking at the brain as if you sliced off the top of my head, you're looking down into it. So if you look in that red circle on your right-hand side there, that's actually the major clinical stroke. So if you look inside that circle, you see there's some dark on the outside, and then there's white on the inside, right? So that white, that light area on the inside, that's an ischemic stroke. That's a stroke from a blood clot that's blocked blood flow. Now, what's interesting and what's so complicated about stroke is that I'm showing you many different types of brain damage. So the first one is this ischemic stroke. Blood flow has been blocked by a clot. The brain rapidly tries to save itself when this happens. And so what's happened here is it's now shunted blood as fast as it can to that brain region to try to preserve brain cells. And you see that black rim on the outside? That's now a hemorrhagic stroke. That's a bleed. So I have a clotting stroke and I have a bleeding stroke together. So firstly, that becomes extremely difficult for an acute neurologist to intervene. So that's problem one, and it's a fairly big problem. But you see those little red arrows on my image as well? Those are also strokes. Those are little small strokes that have happened probably in the past and are also going to contribute to the ability of this person to try to recover some of their skills of daily life. And what we're now starting to understand is that these small strokes, these what we call microlesions, are pervasive. And in fact, we'll have patients that will have hundreds of these microlesions in addition to their major stroke. And it's only been through the advancement of imaging, of MRI imaging mostly in this case, that we're able to start to understand what those mean, that they're accumulating. We know from work in dementia and vascular cognitive impairment that these are important for cognition, and they may be a major source of dementia. But we're now starting to understand that they also contribute very significantly to motor disability. In fact, we published a paper just this week showing that the accumulation of these together are contributing to a much more complicated patient outcome. So how big a problem is stroke in the world? In North America, someone has a major clinical stroke about every minute. These small microlesions happen at least one per second. So in the time that you've been in this room, we've had over 60 major strokes in Canada and the United States, and untold numbers of microlesions occur in individuals. An interesting thing, though, about stroke is how quickly it's changing. So 10 and 15 years ago, when you went to the hospital and you had a stroke, neurologists would watch you. They would try to keep you alive, but there wasn't really much they could do. That's no longer the case. So acute neurology has changed the face of stroke. And in fact, Canadians no longer die from stroke. 83% of Canadians survive to 1 year after stroke. So because of acute medical interventions, such as medications that can break up a clot, or actually what's really changed the game is the ability to thread something up into the brain and extract a clot, we no longer die from stroke. So stroke has become, in Canada at least, it's a chronic disease. So you'll have this, acute neurologists will keep you alive, and then, unfortunately, those medical interventions most often don't completely abolish disability. So we've now kept you alive. We've kept you alive with some significant disability. And that's where the work in stroke recovery becomes so important, because you still have a very long and hopefully important and productive life that we want to get you back to. So we've tried to solve some of the problems around these issues with thinking about adjunct therapies to rehabilitation. So how could we make rehabilitation care more effective, faster, and restoring you back into your daily life more quickly? So one of the things that we know about the brain is that the single largest driver of that neuroplasticity I talked about, it's your behavior. So there's no drug you can take that will help you recover or help your brain be more neuroplastic. So the biggest thing is, what are you engaging in? How much are you practicing? What are you working on? And the course of recovery, if you simply just practice, is slow and it's hard. And so our idea in my lab has been, could we do something to boost that, to kind of give it a big push? And we talk about it as priming the brain for recovery, or priming the brain really to learn, to relearn those lost skills. So we've done this in a couple ways. We have a robotics lab. We have people both engaging in a static robot, and we are working with a group at Simon Fraser to actually digitally print wearable robotics that you would put on, that you could wear as you're recovering outside of your therapy sessions, even home, and you could be constantly working and having these robots help you engage in your daily life. We're focusing on the upper extremity, but there are other labs here at UBC looking at robotics in the lower extremity and the legs to help recover walking function. The next thing that we've done in my group, and this is really why I came to UBC, was to look at this ability to stimulate the brain. So we can use non-invasive brain stimulation. We can apply current over the top, the outside of the head, and we can drive plasticity. We can drive cortical change with something called transcranial magnetic stimulation. And actually, my lab here at UBC was the first non-invasive brain stimulation lab in British Columbia, and one of the first in Canada. And it was actually established by philanthropy when I was recruited here as a Canada research chair. And we've shown that these brain stimulation technologies can also be effective. There's going to be caveats to all of this, so I'm going to leave it at that. And then the last, and you're probably all groaning, but one of the best drivers of brain plasticity is exercise. And so even small amounts of exercise can be very powerful in preparing the brain to learn and making the brain release neurotransmitters and change patterns of excitability so that you can really get a lot out of a practice session. And so we've looked at all of these. We have clinical trials underway for each of these three interventions with people with stroke, trying to understand which is the best and when would we think about deploying them. So I promised you there would be a catch, and that is the other lesson that we've learned about brain plasticity is it's ridiculously variable from person to person. So all of you, when you leave this room today, your brain is going to be different than when you came in. You'll have changed it by just sitting here and listening and learning. But every single one of you is going to have changed it differently, which makes my job really hard because I can't simply say, oh, we have X therapy and it's for everyone and we're done. So this is one example of that. This is a learning study we did. People with stroke, age-matched controls. All of our individuals with stroke were right-handed, had a right-sided focal basal ganglia lesion. The basal ganglia is a deep brain structure, but they were very similar. People learned, we did brain imaging to understand how did they change their brains as they learned. Everyone learned, by the way, too. And what we found was that our individuals with stroke all learned the task, they showed positive behavioral change, and every single one of them changed their brain differently. Every single one. Now, our individuals without stroke, those healthy controls who were age matched, they showed a much more similar pattern. So it seems that there's something about brain damage, even when that damage is similar, that makes us employ these patterns of variability that are massive, and they make it quite difficult to understand who is going to be best for which therapy and when should we give it. And so that's the problem we're really trying hard to solve right now. So one way that we've approached this problem is by, as my grad students would say, we're trying to put some math on it. So could we use big data? Can we use artificial intelligence? Can we use mathematical modeling to start to develop algorithms, mathematical models that we can weight both with people's behavior, characteristics about their lesion, and then biomarker data that tells us about the state of the brain and come up with predictive models? So the idea here, and this is one of our early attempts at this, is we have algorithms that tell me how much practice any one person would need before they learn a skill. So we could, and we're applying that to rehabilitation. So a patient comes in, and you're going to need to do that 400 times before we say you've learned it. You're not changing anymore. You're as good as you're going to get. But maybe someone else needs to do it 1,500 times or 2,000 times. And so by using mathematics, we can start to model and then appropriately dose rehabilitation and really try to create the right treatment for the right person at the right time. And so the timing of this talk is great. We're going to spend actually the next week, I'm flying in a group of experts where we're really going to work hard to try to make some major efforts forward on this modeling so that we can start deploying it in some of our clinical data sets and really understanding how we can start to leverage these new technologies and approaches to significantly advance how people recover. So this is my vision for the future. I want to see a world where we, if we could abolish stroke, that would be great. I'd be really happy to retire. I'm a full professor and, you know, I could relax a little bit. I'm good with that. I unfortunately don't think that's going to happen really soon. And so instead, what we're trying to do is develop therapies that will most effectively restore brain function as quickly as possible so people can get back to their daily lives. And this applies to all people, by the way. So stroke is not a disease just of the elderly. Actually, women are highly and disproportionately affected by stroke. One of your highest risks as a woman for stroke in your life is when you're pregnant. So we're talking about young people as well, people who will live with this disability for an extremely long time. If it occurs. And so we really must develop new therapies and new approaches to restore these people back to their daily lives. And we're hoping to lead not just Canada, but the world in those efforts here at UBC. And in part, it's because of support from people like you, from our province and our government, and centers like this one that bring us all together where we can think about these big problems, that I'm pretty confident we're going to make some big successes here.